Good evening, everyone. I'm Joana Gonçalves from the SED, the Master Program, Environment and Energy, BA Graduate School. I'm very pleased tonight, honored to introduce the lecture that closes the day of the EMARC's final presentations in the Architecture Association this year. And it's a very special project and a very special day for us. We are going to see the process, the thoughts, and some of the key architectural, environmental, and structural features of the London 2012 Velodrome, which is a fascinating building which has been publicized a lot in the media. And interesting enough, the opening lines of an article published in the RIBA journal in April 2011 said, if there was a 2012 Olympic medal for architecture, the gold would surely go to the Velodrome, which is probably what the public and the design team and the client, everybody's very happy with what we're going to see tonight. The building is recognized throughout the UK and also internationally by a number of well-regarded institutions. The London 2012 Velodrome, it is an outstanding example of integrated and sustainable design. That's why we are here today. It got a number of awards, including the Prime Minister Better Public Building Award. It was shortlisted for the Sterling Award and many others. What we are receiving here tonight, Mike Taylor from Hoppings Architects, senior partner of the practice, who completed his architectural education at the McIntosh School of Architecture in Glasgow. And Mike will be joined by Ed McCain, Director of Expedition Structure Engineers, who joined the company in 2012, and also Gustavo Brunelli from BDSP Partnership, who is going to give us the environmental perspective of the project, associate in BDSP, and also a member of the SED staff and ex-student of the AA, has a long history here. The key players, then, of the design of the London 2012 Velodrome will talk about methods and solutions that make this building a true case of integrated and sustainable design, ultimately achieving high-quality architecture and engineering. Aiming for creativity and engineering rigor, the Velodrome, built for the London Olympics and the Paralympic Games by the Olympic Delivery Authority, excels in ingenuity and efficiency. The integrated design solution had to address both functional needs whilst still ensuring the highest degree of energy efficiency for current and future scenarios. And in that context, it's important to say that the environmental performance, different aspects of the environmental performance of the building is set to excel all targets, and it actually does. Confirmed in design and now operation will show us, resulting in the most sustainable building of the Olympic Park declared publicly. So it's definitely an exceptional building in the history of architecture. So welcome, join me in welcome. We're gonna start with Mike Taylor to see tonight.
Can you hear me okay? You must all be exhausted. We've got 120 slides. It's 4.5 hours. No, we'll do 1 hour of talking if we can keep to about 30 seconds a slide, and then we'll have 20 minutes, half an hour for questions, which will probably wake you up a bit. So actually, it's all complete nonsense because sustainability is a relative thing. This is Herne Hill Velodrome, which some of you probably know, in southeast London, built in 1892 and used for the 1948 Games. It's got 20,000 people standing around the track. That's pretty sustainable. No HD cameras, no 3,000 lux. So it's really all relative to our expectations, isn't it? Everyone will fly to London. Everyone will be housed in lovely, comfortable accommodation. It will be on HD TV, all that kind of stuff. And I think I have to caveat everything we're saying by saying I've done LEED buildings, BREEAM buildings. At no point in that process does it say, A, do you need the building? Or B, how big it should be. So we're totally focused on sort of this model of efficiency without looking at the big picture at all. And there's a great story here. Tommy Godwin, who won a bronze medal for Britain, lived in Birmingham, had a friend in Red Post Hill around the corner, stayed the night there, did his race, and then rode back to Birmingham on his bike. So that puts it into context. Previous velodromes, they're a slightly tricky building type in that they're not tied down. It's not like football. Even football has variation in the pitch. Cycling has an enormous amount of variation. It's a regulated sport, but not that much. So Atlanta, they had a prefabricated track outdoors. Sydney, they built a new 3,000-seat velodrome, quite nice, outside of town. Athens actually took an old hardwood track that was outdoors. Santiago Calatrava put a roof over it, and then they came along afterwards and put glazing around it to seal it, which is a bit of a mistake because in the games there's quite a lot of air movement which affected the athletes. It's not necessarily fair. And then finally, Beijing, there's a German architect, track designer called Ralph Schurmann, who's third generation track designer, but he's also an architect, so when he gets the job of designing the track, he also bags the job of designing the building. And that's absolutely gargantuan structure. It has a basement and another building at the side. And that was 3,000 seats with some capacity to add extra seats in the games. The thing about the London bid, which makes it more interesting perhaps than the ones that had gone before, was this notion of what happens afterwards, the dreaded legacy word. And most of those Olympic parks have had terrible problems because they're out of town, the buildings have cost a fortune, and there's no real business case for running them at that sort of capacity afterwards. So this is the A to Z converted to show it, with the velodrome at the top, the Olympic Stadium at the bottom, and Westfield over to the east. You might have seen this if you've driven along the A12, you'd have seen the velodrome. Most of you have not gone on site, I imagine. There is a test event which is fully televised in February, so you'll see it there. So the piece really that the team put together, and it was very much an integrated team all working together, right from the outset, was a philosophical proposition about how you do a velodrome working back from this idea of legacy. And Ed, who's speaking later, coined this expression, a housewarming party. And the notion was that, well, okay, you can build this wonderful house for yourself, but really the games should be a party in the house, and we should be designing the house to be a house for later, i.e., we should design a building to last 50, 100 years and work very efficiently, and they can convert it for the games, not the other way around. And the interesting thing about London as well was we have this sort of tract of land to the east, this enormous discrepancy in wealth between the west and the east. Could we, as a wider Olympic project, stitch the city back together? And this was the great image Rem Koolhaas, I think, had put together for the bid. And so there's a series of communities around that area. It's not total desolation. And they're very separated, or were separated, by the Lower Lee Valley. And they could be linked in a really complex way because it's a very difficult set of territories and levels and communities around the Olympic Park. On the right there, you'll see, and it's a nice drawing, this, because it sort of sums up the effort of making the games and puts it in the context of the Victorian parks. And I think the great legacy of this Games will be the park. Our job was actually quite complicated because before we won the Olympics, the Lee Valley, who operate 32 kilometres of the Lee Valley Park, had put a proposal forward, not planning, but a proposal to build a fantastic cycle park that crossed the A12 and was about the size of half the Olympic Park. So the cyclists thought they were going to get this. So when we won the Olympics, everyone else was excited, but they thought we were going backwards because they were never going to get as much land again. And in the briefing document we bid for in the competition, this encapsulated what everyone thought they were going to get. They thought they were going to get a velodrome on the left for the games with 6,000 fixed seats in it. Very straightforward, a good decision. We don't have the problems that aquatics have of making it change size. A BMX park with 6,000 temporary seats alongside what was going to be the fencing arena. And that would all be fitted into the Olympic Park somehow. Afterwards, on the right-hand side, the vision was then to add a one-mile cycle circuit and to move the BMX and keep it there for legacy and add one or two other things in and build housing roundabout. So we did start from the back and work to the front, and we, over quite a few months, thought that process through a bit better and decided, well, we should only build the BMX course once and not move it. we should put the two together and get the benefit of all the services and amenities in the velodrome. And we should really plan this as a piece of park. So the word Velo Park came out, and it will have the 250-metre indoor track. It will have the BMX, which will make it a bit safer for people to use. And it will have 6.5 kilometres of mountain biking and a 1-mile circuit for training on. So this is absolutely instrumental to the success of the velodrome afterwards. Manchester Velodrome costs over £250,000 a year to run. So they don't make money. So you have this enormous challenge. How can you make it? You're spending that money, you're spending money heating it, putting lighting in it. What benefit can you get from it? And the main thing is to get people exercising. We've recently reconfigured that. We've been working with the Olympic Park Legacy Company. I'll show a movie at the very end, on about the fourth hour, of how we've reconfigured the park. But we've worked very closely with George Hargreaves and his team in shaping the building into the park. All the teams work very independently, and the master plan was sort of struggling to keep up with the individual teams. So it's quite complicated. So there's a plan which represents it in Olympic mode. So there's a sort of smaller park available, and then the pink is how you access things. And there's a lot of project managers on a job like the Olympics, and they have some very big concerns about money and time, and you need to talk their language to be successful. And we had a sort of unwritten code, if you like, that would never mention aesthetics at any time on the project. Although they're obviously in our mind. And so we talked about everything in quantities. So we talk about steel weights, about efficiency, and talk a language that everyone could understand on that side of the table. Because you go to meetings, there'd be about the same number of people as in this room trying to make a decision about to approve something or not. Very, very bureaucratic and really challenging for the design team. So this is where we started from. This is the map with the Eastway cycle circuit on it at the top. This was the state of the site. There's a lot of romance talked about the site by people like Ian Sinclair, but it was pretty damn grotty. And the ODA done a fantastic job at keeping to their deadline, so there was a lot of demolition. There were power lines on the site, which they took down. And there's an extensive network of tunnels underneath to house all those cables, in other words, to make a site. And the contamination across the site was quite extraordinary. You'd see this soil that would be sort of glistening black, like treacle, full of God knows what. And so the ambition really, which was realised, was to keep as much soil as possible on site, to have what are called soil hospitals. This is one that would clean the soil and reuse it and distribute it around. So there was a sort of cut and fill balance between the different projects to use the earth that had been remediated. This was before we started. This was what's called the Eastway circuit, and this is what the cyclists had and owned and were very passionate about, and they thought they were getting a much bigger piece of land to extend that. This was about a 1-mile circuit with about 21 metres change of level that was used for racing, mainly by amateurs, but had been used in the 70s for professional racing as well. So how do we go about putting a building in an Olympic park? And this was the very first diagram, really, which was about this velodrome is an Olympic velodrome, and it's going to be in the legacy mode, and it's going to connect to all the other forms of cycling. So what does that say about the architecture? Well, it needs to have a visual connection between the inside and the outside. So we had this concept, which we developed for the building, that it would sit very much as part of the park, and there would be a much stronger relationship between inside and outside than any other velodrome we'd seen before. So these were the four key diagrams that everything really about the building has to be focusing on the track. Peter Buchanan made an interesting comment when we were showing him the scheme that he'd been to see the Tour de France and he'd had his picnic and sat there, and there was about a 10-second burst of cyclists going past. He spotted the genius of a velodrome in that you stay still and they keep going past you. And I think he's right. So they go around in the same direction as athletes for some reason, anti-clockwise. And the track, we'll come onto the track, it's quite a sophisticated thing. But what we wanted to do was take half our audience of 3,000 spectators and wrap them around the track, which is not always the case in velodromes because it's so steep on the banking. But it's good to get some noise and some crowd activity all the way around. On the jury, Sir Chris Hoy was one of the jury members, and he was very keen and supportive of this idea because he says what happens is most velodromes don't have people at the ends. You have all the judges and the officials on one side. So you have your people cheering down one straight and not for the rest. So we were very keen to keep the press and the officials as far away from the track side and get proper supporters around the whole track. We then, behind those 3,000 people, built a concourse, and the idea of that was to provide this link between inside and outside and put the remaining 3,000 people in the roof, tucked away. And this seemed a good idea because in normal use, after the Olympics, you'd only have maybe a crowd of 2,000-3,000 for some national event, and you could therefore hide away the seats at the upper level and not make it feel like a very empty stadium. And we had a very, very stripped back image for the competition. We presented it as a series of ideas, and we were very constrained by a planning cone that had been determined by some consultants, and we had to fit the building in it. And that's why this thing curved up at the sides, because it just wedged into this shape like a yogurt pot we'd been told it had to fit in. And so we stripped out any ideas of landscape on this and just showed this clean line of glass that would connect the inside to the outside. And clearly this sort of relationship between the track, the geometry, the dynamism of the wooden circuit and the building above having some sort of correlation, and a notional cable net type structure at the top. That progressed, and we, in repositioning the building to improve the ground conditions, also managed to increase the width of this cone we had to fit it in, so it had straight sides and became a much more efficient diagram, which Ed will expand on, but also a nicer diagram, and allowed us to use wood on the underside without it getting wet. So this was just a simple model we developed early on, and that developed into this piece, which shows pretty much that concept, the track. The lower bowl of 3,000 seats, the concourse, the structure coming up, and then the other seats. This is at the midpoint, and then a berm which takes you up to that level. In Olympic mode, it's just worth saying that the crowd all come in at the upper level, and the athletes come in at the lower level. And as a spectator, that will happen for any event, or if you want to go to the cafes. If you come in as a cyclist, you'll come in at the lower level. Thank you, David. Great stuff. Okay. And we were working very strongly with double curvatures on this project. So we sort of instinctively knew, going back to the secret aesthetic agenda, that we'd have a fantastic shape. These two counterposing forms would inevitably work very well for us. And they came out for reasons of efficiency, but also because it suited us to have the high seats on the straight here and the few seats on the steep part of the track at this point. And we wrapped the skin of the building very, very tight around that. So we couldn't go any higher than we needed to here, which brought the roof down, and likewise at this point. And that gave rise, those are two sections, one you saw through there and one you saw through here. So you get this sort of figure of eight shape, which changes as you move around it. All very rationally worked out. This talk is going to make it sound incredibly linear and rational. It's not always that straightforward. And the project managers, our beloved brethren in that profession, I can use that word, also had an enormous amount of attention on how much money was being spent on all the projects. And there's some pretty tough cookies out there giving us a really hard time on anything to do with costs. So we, our sort of ambition to make this as lean and as mean as possible was a very good way forward for a project of this nature. What you find on these sorts of jobs is that the amount of money the government have been told it will cost is probably what they want to hear or even asked for, and they'll incrementally let out the bad news of how much it really costs. So the papers make it look like it's out of control. People pretty much know at the start what it's going to cost, the whole project, but it can only be incrementally let out. I think that's probably true the world over. We were very proud of what we managed to achieve on our budget. There's some pretty serious overheads working on an Olympic site, but our contract value was £65 million, and our contractor ISG, who did a very good job, they reckon if you built it off the Olympic Park in Milton Keynes, so it cost about £40 million. I'm going to hand over to Ed, who's going to fill you in on the structural side and sort of carry on this story of the pursuit of efficiency.
One of the other things that was high in our minds when we were doing this was that if you hadn't invented cycling, now would be a good time. That cycling captures the zeitgeist in a way with exercise, the need for exercise, economy, not driving around, not overcrowding cities and so on. And it's fair to say that our team was more than usually keen on cycling, in particular Mike, who has a good lycra set and fast bikes. And so from very early on, this was cycling focused and cycling centric. And some of our inspirations in terms of the engineering solutions and the in a sense, the spirit of the thing was the simplicity and beauty of a well-engineered bike. Long span structures, one of the things that characterizes stadia in general, and certainly enclosed stadia facilities like this, is that they have long span roofs. The roof on the Velodrome is about 130 meters from end to end and from side to side, and that introduces a very important consideration. If you're doing a roof like this, which spans perhaps 7 or 8 meters between columns, it doesn't matter desperately how you get from side to side. That you can do that job with a beam, a straightforward linear element, or a slab, and it won't cost that much. When you get into much longer spans, the costs increase very substantially. And this graph shows that. This is Chris Wise's doodles. But effectively, what it says is that as the span increase, the weight is proportionally different depending on the nature of structure. So if you look at the flat one up the top and you follow that curve, on short spans it doesn't matter a huge amount. By the time you get over to the other side, a flat structure is extremely inefficient in structural performance. A single curve, like an arch or barrel vault, is better, but still not great. And double curvature begins to generate real benefits of efficiency. And so it is always the case that if you're looking for efficiency in structure on long spans, you look for curvature, because the form helps you deliver efficient structure. And that was very early on. And always you will find that people who design stadia, if that's why you see arch structures and shell structures a lot on long span roofs. Typical on airports and typical on warehouses and structures like this as well. So we were looking for double curvature for structural efficiency. An awful lot of the money in a building like this is in the roof structure, and we were against the budget. The downside, of course, of doubly curved surfaces is that they are relatively complicated to form and fabricate when compared to simple flat things. This is a bicycle seat, and it has one line of symmetry. Those of you will see that down the middle it's the same. So you can imagine any little square on there, if you were to plop a square on it, there would be one on the other side, so two. So you've got no repetition, you've got one degree of repetition in that form. It might be structurally efficient, but we're going to have to make lots and lots and lots of bits and join them together rather carefully. This is a common problem in here, and one of the reasons why a lot of shell structures in the past that you've seen are generated from particular forms of geometry. Those of you who are interested in geometry will see domes. Domes have characteristics which make them more than usually replicable and easy to fabricate. A technique that, I'm not sure who originated it, but this technique was used on the Duxford American Air Museum back in the 90s, where with Arup and Foster's doing the roof structure there. And what is done here is we take the geometry of a toroid and we find a double curved surface off it. If you look at the top one up there, that little blue bit there is actually comes out looking a bit like a Pringle, but it has the characteristic that around the toroid like this you have everything's the same. So if you follow around any line going around the central axis of the toroid, all of those pieces will be the same at the same distance from the center. So you begin to get repetition. So on the 90 meter spanning Duxford, there are only 6 forms used to form that surface. So although it looks complex, by finding the underpinning geometries, you get something that becomes rational and efficient to construct. And broadly speaking, this is what we did on the Velodrome as well. So we use that geometric trick, which generates a particular form and geometry. You then end up tweaking it because the cables are on an orthogonal grid and there are various other things that go, but you're very, very close to a very simple geometry, which makes it economical to construct. We are under a lot of pressure. I mean, Mike pointed to this, and we were always being asked to explore other options. No one could quite believe that a building that looked like that would actually be cheap. So there was an expectation that if a building looked like it had double curvature and timber all over it, it was going to be an expensive building. So we kept being asked to look at biscuit tins, versions of biscuit tins, inclined biscuit tins, or all sorts of simplified geometries to to come up with something that was cheaper. And again, John Cox to Smith, one of the other quotes which is not here, he was the head of cost control, he ended up writing a report to the seniors in the Olympics saying, actually, this is so efficient, this building, that the architecture's for free. Because they found their answer through efficiency and rational processes, actually you're getting an aesthetic and it's not costing you anything. If we do this as a biscuit tin, it's going to cost you the same. So this was very important. We went through all of this, it took months, and eventually we settled on an answer. I happen to think actually that that cost pressure was useful. I think it made us really think hard about prioritising what mattered. And I think overall, normally you would say this is a horrible thing, but you know, I think that the proper attention to price kept us on our toes and made us focus on what we needed to do, and sometimes made us think twice about things. Structurally, you can kind of begin to see the overall structural diagram here. So having established an efficient geometry, that's to say a doubly curved surface and all the rest of it, you start talking about, well, what? How do we make that geometry? And the Velodrome has, it's effectively a piece in three layers. And so you start in the ground, and in the ground on a contaminated site, you use concrete. So we used concrete, precast piles on the hull, which were banged in, and big, heavy concrete structures good in the ground. We then moved into a different concrete realm once you got out of the ground, and the lower seating bowls and the concourse were made out of fair-faced concrete, high quality, no finishes on it at all. This is an example of where we're being pushed on price, so we think very carefully about the finishes and the way that we form the structure so that we don't need finishes. And so the second tier is a layer of in-situ reinforced concrete to a fairly high standard. And then above that, where we're worried about weight and structural efficiency, we move into the land of steel. And so we have this steel bowl here, which is set on a broadly radial grid, a transfer truss beam that runs around the edge and acts like the warped ring of a tennis racket, holding what will become, as you'll see in a second, a net structure roof. There we are, a net structure roof. It's a cliche really, but the most efficient way to use structural materials is generally in tension, certainly some structural materials is in tension, and the lightest and most efficient structural forms known in nature are nets. They're a very efficient form, and if you just think for a second how immensely thin a spider's web is and yet manages to do what it does, you'll realise how efficient they can be. And what are our equivalent of the spider's threads? Well, they're these roughly 140, at longest 140 metre long, 36 millimetre steel cables. This is in Germany where Pfeiffer are fabricating the net system, and these you might... If you think about what you're trying to do here, you've got these two points up in space and you don't know exactly where they are. You're going to join a cable to them up there. You're going to join them all up and sort of jack it up a little bit, and it's all going to go bing and suddenly be a functioning roof, which is a pretty astonishing thing. There is no tolerance worth speaking about built into this system. This hasn't got turnbuckles on it. These are cut to length, faced up, and then jacked into place. And so these are stressed. The reason they're laying them out like that is they pull them. They put the load into them that they're going to get in operation, and then they're cut to within a millimetre of the length that they need to be once they're in the stress state. It is quite an operation. That's what it will look like. Those of you, we'll come back to how do we model and represent this sort of thing, but from the give-go, we use a combination of sketches, physical models, to explore stuff, and parametric models, structural models, and we sort of, it's a bit like we if you're a carpenter, you move around the desk using the tool that's necessary to do the task. But this is using some of the most advanced parametric stuff that's out there at the same time as we're knocking holes in lumps of wood to see whether things can fit together. And I think that's an important lesson for those of you who are inclined one way or the other, either to work with paper all the time or work with computers all the time, that it's this sort of stuff does really require an ability with a lot of different tools. The cable net, having all those things having been cut to length and brought to site, They're laid out on site with chalk marks on them, and the nodes are connected up. They're laid out on the ground like that, and they're dangled off the points of attachment. And then using strand jacks, they're lifted up into the sky. Now, if I give you a comparator, a comparison on this, the entire process of setting the cables up, lifting them into place, and contractor of that part of it going home was 8 weeks. If I put a comparator to that, when we started piling, they were building the roof on the aquatics. When we finished our entire job, they were still building the roof on the aquatics. The construction period for the roof structure on aquatics was broadly the same as our entire construction period, because it's a different technique that involves several thousand tons of steel all being joined together and blah, 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 like that. So this is a very convenient system if it's appropriate in your circumstances. Incidentally, one thing you won't see in any of these images is scaffolding. This is a building built without any scaffolding. And so, again, this is the technology we're using avoids the need for those sorts of expensive, time-consuming, and safety-endangering systems of access. This is it being jacked into place. It's got catch net on it. We've got a little video. This is a time-lapse of them going up. It did have, I like to ride my bicycle playing in the background, but someone decided not to play that. And up it goes. I think all of us who were involved in it and who hadn't done one before, because none of us had actually put one up before, we knew what they were, we were all kind of astonished about how relatively straightforward it was. You know, people came out, they pressed buttons, zzz, up it went into place. And actually, the erection of the cable net was remarkably straightforward. It used very few people, completely prefabricated. The stuff all came out in rolls with labels in it. They laid it out, they joined it up. And I don't recall a single problem with the installation of the cable net, which is pretty remarkable when you think it's relatively uncommon technology in Britain. We don't do many of these, although they're common around the world. Here we have the strand jacking operation going on. So that guy you can see dangling on a bit of a rope there. He is basically making final adjustments to the connection point. And I think actually what he's doing there is checking that the stress is right. So he's doing a quick check that all is well. Once you put it up, we measure displacements and stresses to make sure that it is where it needs to be. But interestingly, you'll see around the edge, the entire access to the roof used a ring truss. And it kept people safely away from walking around on top of the roof. They didn't need to. No one needed to walk on the roof to do structural work at all at this stage. You can see there that what that shows them as the stressing operation is going on. So you stress parts of it and different parts of it at different times. So you do that one first, then the other one. You pull them against each other. And really, there's a final tuning operation to pull them all precisely into place. The order with which you stress them is rather important. And one thing to understand about a building like this is it's moving all the time. And so when we build the steel, it's hanging at the big wings at the top. They're hanging out like that. We put this stuff on, and they come in a certain distance because we jack them together. We put the panels on, it comes in a bit more. And so we have to solve all of the tolerance problems and fit problems at every stage of that motion, which might be 200 millimeters at each side of it during that process. That's quite a significant thing to get it to work under those different modes of loading. That's it in place and what it was like inside. With the net on, then people were perfectly free to go in and carry on working inside, something that can't happen when you're doing normal roof construction, because of the fact that people are over your head all the time, so it's difficult to work. This detail here, people have said that the Velodrome has got innovation in it, and I don't think any of us think of it as a particularly innovative building, but one thing that was unusual on this was the particular combination of cable net plus timber cassettes, then insulation, then calzip. And those different systems actually all need different things. Their tolerances for movement are quite different. The net wants to move around quite a lot and can. The timber wants to move around with the net, but it can't unless we leave gaps. And then the calzip panels, which are sitting on top, can move least of all. And we reckon that in our practice, we probably spent 20% of our entire effort in sorting out and making sure that that system, in terms of tolerances, worked. And so the effort that we put in was 20% of our work was making sure that that worked. So beware if you ever try and put a essentially rigid or intolerant surface on top of something that wants to move. Getting the system to work so that it it performs is a major challenge. And this is an area where actually the architects and the engineers were in, you couldn't separate them. I mean, we were absolutely on top of each other trying to make these things work. The characters, they became very good friends who worked on this for months. Forged steel nodes, all exactly the same. So the cable, the clamping detail. A lot of effort goes into these sort of things to get them just so, and beautifully done and easy to made. I don't know if we've got a... You can see the system going together there, so you've got the cables. There's the little piece we were just... that's the little piece we were just looking at. Clamps around the cable, holds it nice and tight. And then on top of it, we have this seating piece onto which the panels will ultimately sit. They'll sit with a corner in each of these. And it's there that we start things moving around. And you see in that seating piece, big round holes, slotted holes, tiny little holes. And that those holes are effectively movement. They're to allow movement so that the piecing on top can slide in one direction on a slotted hole, not at all in a little hole, and any way you like on the other ones. On top of that then sit the cassettes, on top of that the insulation, and right up the top your calcite panel. So that's insulation, that's timber cassettes, that sits on top of the node, that sits on top of the wires. All of these panels were made up off-site by a company which has now gone bust actually, but very, very simple construction. This is just plywood. I mean, they're basically 6x2 bits of plywood with, bits of timber with plywood sheets top and bottom. And they've got a temporary coating on top there. The black stuff you can see is to enable you to walk around. And then there's a tape up that you put across the joints as a temporary waterproofing measure as you're working. And the underside of it, and Mike may talk about this later, but is fair finished ply with a very light oiling on it, as I recall. No finishes again, and you'll see that inside. And essentially, you just swing them in, you drop it down onto the nodes, fits into these little grooves, you put in a couple of screws, and that's it. 1,080 panels, and they all went in very quickly without too much hassle at all. There's a panel being laid in. I mean, it's actually, one of the reasons this building is seen as a very high-performing building in environmental terms is it is to do with the amount of timber that's used in it. So sustainably sourced and carbon sink material like timber is good in those terms. And you can see it better than I can say it there. And that is pretty much it. So that's located in its lugs. They then screw it in and away you go. Which meant that, I mean, you know, they can put that in. They'll put 50 of those in a shift. So in less than a month, you've got a roof on for a 13,000 square metre roof in about the time it takes to do a single storey extension in Dulwich. That's the inside. And again, a characteristic of the Velodrome is there's no fuss, no frill. If you like it or you don't like it, every single thing you're looking at there is doing something. From the little knob on the bottom of there, to the cable, to the way it sits on there, to the way that sits on there. No finishes, bar a bit of oil. This is an example of how... this is a daylight factor. So the model we're using to represent this, to do studies on daylighting, to do structural studies, or to do geometric studies on sight lines in the seating bowl is essentially the same thing. So we were using, I think you guys were using a generative components model, which we would chop apart and use in structural analysis programs. And all of these things were set up with routines to speak to each other. So we were all basically, by this stage, operating off the same information. We did a lot of talk about BIM this year, but I mean this process, we've been using that for a while. Skylights in there, and I'm sure Gustavo will talk about those later. Those are the slots at the top. More GC modelling, showing some examples of models. Now, what are, there's a happy accident on the Velodrome, actually, to do with what goes on at the edge. If you looked at the early renders of the Velodrome, you'll see that the calzit came right to the edge. And originally, when it was thought of, the calzit would come to an edge into a gutter, and then you'd have the little upstands. What we found was that we, in order to solve the problem I was talking about earlier, which is to get the net and the panels and the calzit to work so that they didn't, one of them didn't fall, pull apart because of differential movement, was we couldn't do it at the edges. The level of flexibility at the edge was too much for us to accommodate with calzit panels. And so we switch from calzit around the strip at the edge to a membrane. And curiously, if you'll see the views of the roof, and certainly in my opinion, it's far superior the way that that's resolved itself aesthetically. And I think that one goes down in the happy accident territory. And this is around the edge and reflects the fact that around the edge we've now got to get from one system to another and then into a gutter, which is provided around the outside. Talk a little bit about the gutter. Big roofs, these. So there's 13,000 square metres. You've got roughly 185 litres a second as a peak flow in the gutter. And the logic of something like this could have one downpipe at either end, this building. As it happens, we've put two downpipes in on the to mitigate against the risk of an ostrich blocking one of these downpipes, in which case it can go down the other one. But we actually only need one downpipe at either end. And what we tried to do with the water was marshal it, keep it flowing fast, because fast-flowing water occupies less space. That allowed us to minimise the upstands as you work across the roof. It allows us to minimise the geometry of the gutter and consequently the whole building. And then to bring it in an orderly fashion, speed it up in the way that we do on dams, so it shoots down a hole and away. And everyone was kind of, I remember the meeting actually, where I was dragged in to say, are you sure this will work? Because the builders had never seen anything like this with so few downpipes. They wanted to put 30 downpipes on it, and they couldn't believe that we were going to put all the water down this tiny little hole. And to prove it to them, to us, the Cat 3 checkers, we did, this is a computational fluid dynamics model showing water coming over off the edge into the gutter and making sure it just doesn't shoot up the other side. Water goes quite fast here. We've got peak velocities. You see the purple there. The purple up here, that's 6 meters a second, you know, so it's water crossing this room in 2.5-3 seconds. So it's highly supercritical, as the jargon goes. And controlling it and making sure it goes where you want to is a bit of a challenge. This is a physical model that of the downpipe arrangement, because, by the way, we didn't want this great big monstrosity of a hopper sticking on the outside of the building. So we brought it along in the gutter, and then it's tucked in the roof structure, which contains this channel here, and then put into a vortex drop shaft and down the pipe into the core of the building, where on one end it's harvested for rainwater harvesting and at the other end it just goes straight to the drain. So a combination there of techniques of conceptual design done with a pencil, rough sizing, computational fluid mechanics, and then physical modelling to deal with the more complex geometric problems of flow. What's this one? Ring beam steelwork. I think one of the features of this, one of the reasons, if any of you ever see cable net roofs, if you look at the Olympic Stadium, for example, it's got a very, very substantial ring truss. The standard approach to cable nets is to resolve all of the horizontal forces at the height of the roof. And so if you imagine a tennis racket, great big edge stops the net pulling in. And the Olympic Stadium is a good example of that. You see the big ring truss sitting at the top. We went another way with this. We said, well, can we use the fact that this has a bowl geometry to resist the horizontal forces? So it's sitting like that. The seating bowls are pushing it down like that. Can we use that effect to remove the need for a big ring truss? And then can we use the fact that a bowl doesn't want to collapse its geometry? If you imagine trying to push a bowl together, regardless of weight pushing out, it is stiff in its circumference. And so we use three techniques to resist and take out the horizontal loads on this system. At the top, we have a relatively small ring truss, which does about 20% of the horizontal load. We then deal with the rest. I think about 15% is in bowl action, and the rest is in cantilevers, which go down to the ground. The point about that, the reason for mentioning that, is not only does it get you a very refined edge, so if you look at the way it comes to a point like that, on a normal system, a normal cable truss roof, that would be a great big lump, this sort of size, with a couple of thousand tons of steel in it. We have managed to keep that in the plane as a single plane of ring truss, which you can see there. So it's just effectively a beam in plan. And the rest of it is done in the structure you're using anyway. So we save many, many hundreds of tons of steel by using this technique. That's the former system for the gutter, which was constructed in wood. Turned out to be a doddle. We were all thinking that rather complex three-dimensional geometry would be a bit of a nightmare, but actually wood is very, very forgiving for that sort of construction. And so once you've set those frames up, you can generate three-dimensional twisting geometries very easily. And again, no problems at all with that, and then it's just got a waterproof liner inside it. Those are the bits being taken into place and then bolted together. There they are. Skin tight, which there are some really shocking pictures of our project manager in Lycra, which we keep threatening to put on the internet, but he keeps begging us not to. I think so, yeah.
Sorry, I missed your last slide.
Okay. So you're probably getting the idea that this thing is like a bicycle, and that we sort of took every single component and really got into what makes that work, refined it. But also all of those components are interdependent and each one affects all the others. But a bit like a bicycle, at the end of the day, when you go to the shop, it's got to look pretty good, otherwise you're not going to buy it. So cladding, we took that same philosophy of prefabrication of modular components into the cladding system. And interestingly, the whole building is faceted. Apart from the track and the ring beam, almost every single thing is flat because it was easier to make. We hid the flatness in the way we did everything and made it look curved. But it made it affordable. And here you see how we did lots of studies about how many segments we'd chop this into, and you get this very strong correlation between the structure of the track, the smoothness of the track, and how we managed to replicate that in this bowl shape. But you constantly find yourself, and it's difficult for students because you have this presentation at the end of your project. We have a real building at the end of our project, and so our presentations are to test ideas, really. And there's no point faking it on a presentation if your building at the end is not going to look very good. So there's a certain amount of honesty needed. And as Ed alluded to, we worked in lots of different media because we wanted to check absolutely everything as much as we could. So we had a system of panels not dissimilar to the gutter, made by the same manufacturer who has been bought out and has been salvaged, you'll be pleased to know. So there's the gutter sections. Here's some panelling sections fitting onto these 48 beams, all very rational, all very quick. And then we had systems of the cladding which could be prefabricated. In the end, they elected to nail each piece of cladding on, which was fantastic. It was a work of art, and they did it in that really cold weather. And what they then did was we put these aluminium sections between the pieces of wood, which is part of this story of making facets look curved. And allowed us to have bits of timber. We couldn't have absolutely prime timber. We couldn't afford it. So we knew there'd be variation in the colouring of the wood. And we put this little punctuation in to divide one panel from the next. And this worked very well. And not least when there's very low sunlight, these edges just catch a bit of light. And they help define the geometry of how we split each bay into four panels. What they did was they put this in, they carefully screwed the edges, nailed all of these beautifully in line, and then ran a saw down this, using this channel, just to trim the end of the timber off. This was then treated with Textrol, which is a preservative, which has an oxide in it, which is similar to something found in rhubarb, hence Boris Johnson's comments that this building is not only good for British construction, but also good for British farming, because it's been coated in rhubarb, which then became, it's rubbed down in rhubarb, which then became, it's made from rhubarb. We did have to phone his press office and say, just stop it, will you? We were getting calls from the Sunday Mirror saying how many tons of rhubarb were used in the Velodrome. Sorry to blow that myth for you. Gustavo will talk a bit about how the building breathes, but it's a bit like a fish. It has gills in it. And we did something like 30 iterations of how to put these slots in. It took 6 months to design just getting those slots in that facade. There's a very, very close fit between what happens inside, where these sit on the outside, and how it looks. All very rational. And that whole piece about the roof, this band of non-calzip around the edge of the roof that Ed referred to, how we got that sharp edge, is absolutely critical to this diagram, which is the bowl and this Pringle-shaped roof. And you see here this sharpness. It was a sort of aluminium extruded piece just clipped around the edge, screwed in to resist wind conditions, the slots and everything coming down. So this picture really says everything we were trying to do. Very, very small here, as small as we can go there, cutting sharp geometry, and really, really importantly, right back to that first sketch, the park comes up to this piece of glass, and so a kid in the East End can walk in that Olympic Park, go up to that glass and look in and see Chris Hoy training, and that is the big message for this project. It's open to the inside and the outside, and it gave us the excuse to float this abstract volume above the ground, a bit of magic. So I'll pass on to Gustavo.
Just to tell you a little bit about the analysis and all the sustainability features that we brought in, the environmental features we brought into the building. I think one key challenge we had from the beginning was that this building, yes, it's not a temporary building. It doesn't have demountable seating, but it has to cope with different usages. Not only the Olympics, but also after the Olympics, we will have the big events that will be hosted, like the World Cup, the World Championships, or the Olympics, but we also have the day-to-day activity of the building. And the requirements for those are very different, just as different as the requirement for a cyclist and a spectator in that. So you would have, and things that people never think about, you think a sports building, yeah, it needs to be cool. No, it needs to be hot. Cyclists like it hot. Why is that? Because when it's hotter, the air is thinner, they go faster. So every degree of temperature, of air temperature inside, makes them go a millisecond faster. So that they wanted it to be hotter, ideally up to 28 degrees, even when outside is like -5. So we had to get it hot. But we had to get it hot without making too much air movement. As Mike commented about the Velodrome in Athens, they had the problem with air movement because it was not enclosed during the Olympics. That's not good because the bike is so light, they are going so fast. They can lose balance with that. The other issue was about light. Well, when we have a big event, and for the cyclists, and mainly for the TV, we will have 2,000 lux. They need that to be able to tape in HD the cyclists going around. But that only happens a few days a year, 20 days a year, say, even after the Olympic. Well, what happened on the other time? Well, we only need 18 degrees. We can cope with air blasting, and actually we would like air blasting through in the summer. We can have only 300 lux because that's enough for them to cycle around and see the track and not fall over. But that happens most of the time. And we had to balance all that and get the building to be as efficient as possible and low energy use and low material use, but respecting those. We needed both criteria. So how did we come about that? Well, we started thinking like we shouldn't go for a magic trick or anything. There are good, simple solutions that we can apply to this building and make it work very sustainably, very efficiently. So simple things such as natural ventilation, high efficiency mechanical ventilation, a lot of thermal insulation and daylight were the key things that we put on the building. There is no magic gizmos in it. It is very plain and simple, like robust strategies that applied consciously and very well integrated make it work as well as it does. So what were the first strategies? Like looking at ventilation, looking at how do we get that, it's a big volume and we need to get it to 28 degrees. How do we get that without using too much energy? So if you see on the top, the winter strategy, what do? We bring the air in and we heat the air, but we actually use a lot of heat recovery. So we don't let this air kind of dump hot air outside and bring more cold air in. So we recover most of the heat. The other thing is like, the bigger the volume, the more air we need to heat. So as part of our initial discussions with Mike, with Ed on the architecture of the structure, we said, well, let's bring this roof as low as possible. As low as we can get it, it will help structurally for the double curvature, but we will also bring this down and reduce the volume inside here and help us with our amount of air that we need to heat. Then we look at summer. In the summer period, well, we don't want to cool this building. That's a lot of energy. So we don't have any cooling. All we do is we open some air inlets and outlets and let the air flow freely in and out. So it's fully naturally ventilated. A lot of energy saved in that process. So how do we ensure this naturally ventilated? One another key thing that helped us was the shape. And once again, lowering this and keeping this as high as possible helped us with bringing the air down, bringing the air up and out. So helped us with the ventilation. And that again is with the work together as a team that brought this all together. And then comes how do we integrate in the facade, and that's what Mike was showing about these fins of the fish that let it breathe, and I will talk a little bit more. So now, how did we start? We start by looking at the outside of the building, and again, we used a lot of computational simulations and rule of thumb, so it's a combination of everything to bring it out. So looking at how the air impacts the building outside to look where do we put those fins, where is it better to breathe? So put it up, put it on the side, on which side, and how the building goes, and how the shapes makes the air move around. Then we start looking at inside, and if you look, this is we did a lot of simulation because we wanted to ensure that by having that certain amount of openings, we will get enough air in to make it cool, or at least reasonably cool for cycling. And remember, like we are talking about a building that has to be hot anyway, because the cyclists like it hot. So it's not that we want to make it kind of 16 degrees cool. No, we want to keep it reasonably hot for the cyclist. So one thing was keeping it to a certain temperature, not too hot, but also having some air movement to allow the people who are sitting there to feel a little bit fresher, even though the building is relatively hot for the cyclists. And then locating, and we did a series of studies about where to locate this opening. Do we bring it down? Do we put it up there? Do we dig it under the building? And digging under is a definitely no-no because the soil is polluted. And all those studies came to this option that is bringing air to the sides on the concourse level and through the bowl and leaving it at the very high level. Then we look, okay, but then most of the cycling season is actually in winter and we will need to heat this up. How do we do it efficiently? The interesting bit is we use kind of the same location, and I'll show you a few images. So we use very efficient mechanical ventilation in here, tucked in behind the seating. So we bring the air in, put it in here, but also recirculate the air. And we had to simulate to see that the air is not moving too fast, because once you are blowing air in, you have to be careful so the air goes everywhere, so we have fresh air, but not too fast, because the cyclist wants it still, but hot. So those are the kind of simulations that we did. And we also had a simple underfloor heating system on the infield and on the concourse here, so that for the normal day-to-day that is not too cold outside, you can use that. It's a more efficient way of heating, and you heat the thing for the school kid that is training or for the amateur that is training. If you are on a big training towards a competition, Chris Hoy going there to train, yes, then we switch on the system with the air and get it to the 28 degrees that he wants to train so he gets the time he wants. So where is all the system and how does it work and how is it integrated? The most important thing, and again, one of the things of the pressure, the financial pressure, was also make us think again and make it very streamlined, very skin tight, as the Lycra that was shown with Chris Hoy. So we tucked all the ventilation under the seats, under the upper tier seats. This is natural ventilation. So what do you have here is a plenum, is a void. The air comes in through those fins that you saw outside on the facade and goes out where the people are sitting. And then the hot air that gets created here shoots off to the highest point on the roof, helps with the balance and everything. But the interesting thing is that void doesn't work only for natural ventilation. It is also the same place where you put the mechanical ventilation. So you are saving there and integrating into the architecture all these features. So what you have is all your mechanical ventilation systems are tucked in. And instead of having one big monster machine that blows air, we have 20 small ones. Easier to regulate, easily fit in here, distributed around the whole building. So it can throw the air using exactly the same plenum. So it you don't need two holes for the metro and the mechanical. It uses the same hole under the seats to distribute. So you don't have, the systems are actually talking to each other using the same means instead of having a fully duct mechanical ventilation and another plenum for the natural ventilation. And you can bring the air back down and recirculate it, so you recuperate this heat. But then, if you need to heat this building very quick, you have yet another system that blasts here, but it's again, it's in the same place, it's using those air handling units, it's just integrated into the lower seat here, the very bottom of it, and blasting air, because you need the air to come all the way to the middle. And if you need to heat it up, say you have an event, people came in, you have to heat it up very quick because people came in, it was cold, cold air came in, you switch this on and it will blast air and heat it up very quick. And that was part of most of the simulations, to see that this air doesn't make too much air movement on the track that is just right here. So that's all the system integrated. And you see, this is where the jets come, and this was all integrated into the prefabricated concrete seating. So you can bring the duct, have the jet nozzles here. You can see here it was pre-commissioning, so they are not all pointed in the same directions they will be, or they are now. And then on the outside, it was all integrated into the facade. And the beauty of it is you don't need a slot for the mechanical, a slot for the natural. It's all integrated into this band of slots in there. And you have every other one is pretty much a natural or a mechanical ventilation. But it's all integrated into the architecture. Here you can see the extent of the complexity of fitting that inside. You saw Ed's picture of the structure, the metal structure. And we had to fit all the systems in there. So it's all very thought through. And we use a lot of 3D model exchanging between us to detect clashes so that it doesn't clash with the structure. We don't have a duct running through a beam or something like that. So we had that. And these are the jets. And you see here the machine. So it's all carefully integrated to fit in that very tight space. But that's all we needed. It's very, very tight, very efficient. So we don't need more space or extra space. That means extra money for the building. Here you can see how it comes like before you put the panels. So you see all the ducts coming in there. These are natural ventilation. Here will come the panels with the dumpers in there and then the cladding on the top. The other important thing about putting it there is like the mechanical ventilation is very local. So these ducts are very short. They come from here to the machine that is just around here. And this comes back from the machine and out here. So it's very short duct runs. You don't lose energy. You don't need a bigger fan. You don't lose a lot of heat. So that was important to make the building very efficient. Another aspect that we looked at, this was about ventilation. We looked a lot, and as Ed said, about daylight. It was very important for us. Like there is a lot, it's a big room with a big roof, 13 square meters. It's a big arena. Like, from the onset, it was, okay, we have to daylight this, so daylight this. So a lot of natural light. How do we bring it up? Well, the obvious choice, through the roof. But then how do we bring it up? How do we put it in the roof? Which shape and how much light do we need? That was a critical choice we had to make. And thinking on the sustainability, and as Mike said about the house warming and the actual legacy of the building, like you don't provide daylight for that televised 2000 lux event. That would be just insane. It would be a lot of light. You need a lot of roof light that will make an imbalance on the thermal side of things. So we had to think like, no, we provide for the everyday, the 345 days that you run for children or anything, and you only need 300 lux. So you look at that, and then you design your roof lights that actually provide that for most of the time during the year. And then we looked at how do we integrate that with the structure, with the architecture, with the double curvature. We looked from straight options, wide options, distributed options to circle distributed along the structure. And everything was done, like we used a lot of simulations to check the light, but it was not only about the light, it was about how does it integrate in the whole system of the cables. And at one point we had, this is still with metal beams, so in the as the structure evolved, the roof lights evolved to actually be accommodated with the structure within the architecture. So this is the final option. So we went for the linear one, and to get an even distribution around the track and the infield that would allow us to save around kind of would allow us to run this on natural light for around 85 to 90% of the year. That is quite a lot. So you would only need to switch on the lights for this kind of 15, 10% of the time during the year when you have daylight. Obviously, if you are doing at night, that doesn't count. You cannot have daylight. So those are the roof lights. And you see here, this is a picture for, and it was quite a dull day when this picture was taken. There are no lights on, and you have quite a good level of light. So they work very well. Another requirement and interesting for these roof lights was that we wanted light, but we couldn't have direct sunlight in there. Why? Because sunlight will create patches on this that will distract the cyclist that may cause an accident. So another important requirement here was that it brought diffuse light into it. So we worked with Hopkins quite closely to actually define what glass we could use that would not allow direct sun, but will bring still a good enough or sufficient level of daylight. Otherwise, we'll start to increase and increase and increase this roof light to give the light we want. And the result was that we came up with Hopkins with a very simple PVB interlayer glass with two layers of PVB in the middle of the glass that make it look like a milky glass, but it diffuses more than a normal milky glass. So you don't have that patch of sun striking a bit of the track. Then next, after that, you have to consider, well, you can lift for 80% of the time of a normal day to day, or 85, 90%, but then you have the events, the televised event when you need the 2000 lux. So then what came from that was a very kind of intelligent, let's call it this way, artificial lighting system that could actually talk with your natural light system. So there was a whole lot of design thought coming to the support of it, so it could come up. Remember, like, the roof was erected without scaffolding. Like, we didn't want to put a lot of scaffolding to put the lamps now, right? So what we did is, like, this whole gantry here, this whole, like, support system was put down on the floor and raised up, just like the cable net was, with the lamps already there, already aimed in the direction they needed to be, because all the lamps have a different aiming to provide you the right light levels across the track. Then the other thing is, like, how do you do with a light system that has to provide 200 and also 2,000 and also 300 lux? So you have, the engineers had to think very carefully about how do you use this system. And one very clever thing is, obviously, you can switch off one quarter of the lamps and you had the lower level. But then if you keep using these kind of three quarters of lamp all the time, those lamps will need to be replaced before the others. So it had to become with a system of rotating these lamps so that they provide the level you want, but they kind of have the same life span across the lamp. So you don't have to change always the same set of lamps because they're used more often. So there was a lot of thought into the controls of this. And this is just to show you how it looks with some lights on. At the end of the day, it was all about having the efficiency and getting the building as efficient energetically in energy terms as possible. We had targets from the ODA, and they were quite strict targets. But the important thing was we thought from the onset that we don't want to stick to the targets. We want to do the best we can, and that's beyond the target. So at the end, the targets were about the building, about the infrastructure, about the renewables on the Olympic Park to get a target here that was roughly 50% of the typical emissions. We had control over this bit here. And we thought it was very important for the building to make the most of it and make the least used of energy possible. So the target of 15% here, we achieved 32% reduction in energy compared to a typical one. So that put less burden on the infrastructure and on the renewable energy on the site that was built as part of the whole Olympic site. So we were more than double the target from the ODA. Another thing for us was also, because we had also a very low operational energy, like important on this building is also, imagine a structure like that with a roof of this span, is to have a very low embodied energy. So how do we deal with that? We actually reduced, as Ed was explaining, with the double curvature and the cable net, the amount of steel used in the building is much smaller. And the ODA actually commissioned a study comparing the bird's nest, the the Beijing Olympic Stadium, the Aquatic Center, the Stadium for the London and the Velodrome, to in terms of embodied carbon and different metrics. The important one to see is here is per roof area and see how lower we compare, although we have roughly the same roof area as the Aquatic Center, if I'm not mistaken. Like, we have less than half the embodied carbon on that. And that's all because it was very efficient, lightweight, and built with that. Apart from having embodied carbon, like, we have like loads of others, and I'm not going to bore you with many of those. But then, for instance, water use, we have 75% lower water use than the typical building. That means we use only 25%. Then we have BREEAM, and for you who know, like the standard, and it's bespoke BREEAM for the Olympic Park that was created. We achieved excellent on BREEAM, although the target was just very good. So that shows how we work together to bring this up to the maximum possible level of excellence on sustainability. On materials, like we had in 28% recycled materials, and very important, this building uses a lot of timber, as I had mentioned, and all the timber, 100% of the timber, was actually sustainably sourced. And that includes the track. And that, on that note, I'm just going to hand over to Mike to talk a little bit about the track.
No, we have completely omitted to talk about the field of play, the track, what it's all about. In fact, Herne Hill only had a track, and we've talked about everything else. This is a piece of the track. It's not missing it. It was off the end of one of the pieces they needed. It's an amazing piece of carpentry. We had a fantastic team working on this project, as you probably guessed from the sort of level of integration. And as well as Expedition BDSP, ISG were fantastic as contractors. And we had Ron Webb, who's an Australian ex-cycling champion, who was lured out of retirement to do the track for this. So he designed it. No two tracks are quite the same. It's rather like designing the hull of a yacht. Each time they ask to do a new one, they sort of slightly tweak the geometry. And there's a sort of fascinating thing here that the basic geometry is only fixed by the black line at the bottom, which must be 250 meters minus nothing plus 5 millimeters or something like that. After that, the actual curves, the banking can all be modified by the track designer. So Ralph Sherman, who I referred to before, his tracks tend to be long and thin, and Ron's are shorter and fatter and closer to a circle. And Ron's quite a formidable character. You'll be having discussions with him. We'll come up with ideas. Can we get on the track this way? Can we do this the other way? He'll argue with you. Then he'll go very quiet. And then the third phase is he'll reach down into his briefcase and bring out a piece of paper with a list of all the world records on his track, which means don't mess with me. And one of the reasons he has so many records is the rounder track is obviously better for the sports like pursuiting, where you're going round and you're building up speed and want continuity. The sprinters, conversely, quite like the Sherman tracks because they get a longer finishing straight and they can get past the opponent and possibly beat them to the line on the straight. So there's a sort of whole psychology and science behind the track design. What it consists of are these pretty robust trusses. Different designers actually do different support structure in different ways. And you've got 12 degrees on the straight and 42 degrees on the banking, so quite subtle, the change. And one of the things they're tweaking all the time is that it's not symmetrical. The geometry going into the corner of the steep banking is different from the geometry coming out of it, which makes it a nightmare for architects trying to design precast seating that sit around it. So it's diagonally matching, but not across the axes matching. So these are the trusses. These are the pieces of wood going on like this. It's Siberian pine, FSC certified, and they're fixed on by men who nail it in. It took 8 weeks, so it took the same as the cable net, weirdly. There's about 56 kilometers of timber. They use 5 to 6 meter long lengths, which minimizes the number of joints and allows them to bend it around to the curvature. There's no steaming or pre-bending. They just bend it around, hand nail it in with about 350,000 nails into the timber underneath and obviously into the beam. And they just work from the bottom and work up. Quite a sight. And it is quite hard to stand on, so they put little, rather like roofers, put little bits of timber on to stand on. At Manchester, they wore the track out. They used it so much. And what they did is they came along with a chainsaw and just sawed up between all the beams, got a crowbar and just rolled up the track, and then relayed a new surface on top of the beams. So this should run and run, this one. And there's the finished. And it really is an amazing thing of beauty in its own right. And we have a couple of movies, I think, at the end. Now, this is the best party space in London, which is the space under the track, if you can get there. Quite amazing. And when they're riding over it, you can actually see, even here, little gaps between the boards. You know, it's one big organic thing. There's no joints in it whatsoever. The bottom is 250 metres long. The top is 350 plus metres long. So it changes and flexes all the time. And in fact, before a competition, they'll go in and actually prop these bits here, because before a competition, they'll put the heaters on, warm it up, and so it will start moving even more than normal. So it will need propping at these high points here to stop it vibrating too much. So this is just the everything we've been saying all condensed down. It's interesting, when you see it from eye level in the park, it looks quite a small building, but when you see these views from above, you realise it really is quite big. We done? And we just have one other movie to show, if we could just switch on. This is a piece of work we've just done for the Olympic Park Legacy Company, which was looking at their of how it will sit in the park afterwards. How it will sit in the park afterwards. So this gives you a sort of vision of this amazing new green space in East London, after lots of the temporary venues have been removed. And this was a study we did with the cyclists about how their 1 mile circuit would work, how it would integrate it into the changes of level. So it's done for the planners. No one's seen it before. Retaining construction bridges to use afterwards as the cycle bridges. This big piece of land here on the west bank of the River Lee is for performances and sort of standard park events. That's the A12 over to the left. And this grey patch is the 1 mile road circuit with the two bridges there. And so this idea of the concourse from the very first concept should be very strong, because when you're standing on that concourse drinking your cappuccino, you're able to look out and see your friends and family riding outside or falling off on the track inside. There's the BMX course. This is all for mountain biking roundabout. And we actually take the 1 mile circuit up to concourse level, so the riders will look in as they go past. And in fact, when you go up the banking on the track, you can look out, which Chris Hoy and Victoria Pendleton and everyone said was fantastic, as they went up and looked out the window. Not advised for amateurs. And we were very keen that the sport was on display in the park. I mean, one of the other things about these Olympic parks in other cities is that they're just these buildings, these trophy buildings just plonked down in the park. We wanted very much to bring the cycling across the river and put it on display. so you could get a sense of a sporting legacy and sort of enjoy the park from the point of view of a participant. And it's designed with smaller circuits for school children as well as the main race circuit. That's it. So I think we'll take some questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mike, Ed, and Gustavo, for the incredible presentation. Do we have questions for any of the speakers or for the three of them? I just would like to make one point, the whole presentation was amazing, but it's the importance of highlighting in architecture the value of being truthful about the design. And there's absolutely no excess or nothing there that was not necessary, not needed, and at the same time, everything can together can come out in such a beautiful way. That's an incredible synthesis. Are you shy? Okay, I have a question for Mike, so you can warm up and lose your inhibition. What should we do?
There's a question.
I'll ask you a question.
Okay. You can take that. No, it's almost a curiosity. I mean, we saw so much about wood. And at the same time, when we see the model that Mike showed at the very early on, very beginning of the presentation, the building form, and it's so loyal to the final design, it almost seems that it was born completely right. And very little was changed. So it's actually a question in two parts. First is, how much was really changed from the competition stage and all the main ideas to the final design? The second question would be, at what point was it born as a wooden building? So much wood in it, and if not, at what point it became a wooden building?
It's an interesting project because there's a kind of notion about the relevance of your concept or the purity of it. And I think on this particular project, we set out the philosophical proposition at the start about the efficiency, about the bicycle, about the skin type shape. And we had this notional idea of concourse and this floating bowl. And they absolutely remained to the end of the project. So I think we got those about right. And actually, they're kind of really key landmarks for everyone to latch onto on a big public project like this. You have to carry everybody with you, and you have to be very, very clear in what you do. In terms of the wood, that was an interesting story. I mean, instinctively, you've got this beautiful wooden track. How do you make a building that is, okay, efficient and component-based like a bicycle, but somehow is like a reflection of the track? And so we wanted the dynamism, the geometry on the outside. As a small boy, my dad had taken me to watch cycle racing in Manchester on an outdoor track, and I kind of had it in my blood and knew about that sort of thing. So very much wanted to build on that. In fact, at one point, I was describing it to my wife and said, can you just go to John Lewis at lunchtime and get a wooden bowl? That's pretty much the shape we wanted, because it was this over a bowl. Needless to say, I got a phone call saying, oh, there's nothing like that here. So we built the wooden bowl model. I didn't show you. And we actually snuck it into the interview, because you weren't meant to take things, in a special bag we had made, and handed it round. And it was already this kind of beautiful object. What changed the most, probably, was that we went from the curved sides to the straight sides. And actually, as you look at it now, it looked like we always had the straight sides in our mind. We didn't at all. We were so constrained by this planning cone that we were wrapping the sides over. But thank goodness we managed to change it and do the straight sides.
Thank you. Okay. So we have a full auditorium. Catherine.
Yes, I agree. The integration of the services into the building is really, really beautifully executed. And also that idea of the lycra skin facade is just such a fantastic concept. I was wondering about the environmental targets. I was really surprised to hear you say that the BREEAM requirement was only very good for a building of this, as you say, a trophy building. I would expect excellent or more. Not that I'm not a proponent of BREEAM, but if you're going to use that target, very good is not a particularly high standard. And my other question is that in relation to the requirements of the Olympic Park as a whole? And also, what did you do to supplement environmental targets, given that BREEAM is not a particularly great set of targets in itself.
Well, in terms of the BREEAM very good target, it was a big discussion. We were always targeting as a team to go for the excellent or even beyond that to as much as we could do. The very good, I think it was because the ODA at the onset on the beginning thought it would be too expensive to go for excellent. I think that's why on the actual brief it was written that it's very good, kind of with a target to try to go for excellent, but they never put it as an official target. I think it was a question of a cost. In terms of how we went about to be as efficient as we ended up being, like, I think the key aspect was that from the onset we were not focusing on BREEAM or any of the special targets the ODA set. We knew of them, we had them on the back of our minds, but we went for the target of being the best possible. And I think that's what made us go there. So we went from, say, the 15% energy efficiency that needed. We said, like, forget about that. Let's do the best we can. So we need insulation. How much is the maximum we can within the constraints of shape, weight, cost? So those were the things that kind of pulled us through, and we went through to get the building as efficient as it is. In terms of water, the same thing. So we had, like, it's very interesting in terms of water. We had a target, it was 40%, and we achieved 75%. But then the interesting bit is we are not even using the whole roof. Like as Ed said, like, just half the roof is being collected and recycled. Why? Because we looked at it, we analyzed, we calculated it, and realized that it was not feasible to have both with the two extremes of the building. It would be, we could connect, but it would be like going all around the building and everything. It was not feasible. And just one was good enough to get us what we needed or above, beyond what we needed. So I think, I don't know if that totally answered, but that was the process that we went through. And I think, like, working together was key, so we could work together and not say, like, sustainability as a bolt-on to it. So we worked together. When we wanted the less volume, we worked together for the less volume. When we wanted the natural ventilation, we had, like, the 32 interactions of how we integrate that into the facade, get the area we want, the aesthetics we want, the finish we want, and the location we want. So all of that was part of kind of achieving the sustainability goals that we set ourselves.
I'll just add one thing, which is going back to that very first thing I said, that you know, these systems are so limited in how they look at everything. And the best thing we could do on this is ensure it had a long and successful life. You know, it costs a lot of money to run, it costs money to operate, and you can actually cycle outside. So, you know, what are you trying to do here? Well, you're trying to get people exercising, you're trying to put on highly competitive sport and raise people's sort of knowledge and enjoyment of it. And there's so many of these things that don't succeed because they cost money to run. And so we, you know, lower the running costs, make it very pleasant to be in, and make it a success in the park is a much bigger story than how much energy you're saving. And I'm so sceptical about LEED and BREEAM. I mean, an igloo would fail abysmally. So there you go.
I mean, from my perspective, I never gave it the slightest bit of attention. Not a moment's thought went into that. That came up from time to time, where the whole question of targeting came up from time to time, when someone said, how are you doing against that? I mean, as Mike says, the focus was completely other, which is do something you believe in and things will spin out okay, and they did. I think it's worth saying, actually, the Olympics, in all of the projects I've worked on some major program-type projects like Terminal 5 before, this had the most developed environmental and sustainability management system of any that we'd worked on. And so there were things that you just don't normally see, like an active team coming to you talking about procurement and helping you understand sustainable. So, for example, concrete specifications. They developed a specification for concrete with a high level of recycled aggregate, working with London Concrete. And this building was built with that specification. And so there was a huge amount of support when it came to that sort of thing provided by the ODA sustainability team, which we haven't talked about really, but was actually quite important. They were also very interested in this. So whatever the targets they set, that didn't reflect the lack of ambition. Gustavo was absolutely right. Right at the beginning, they were scared that if they put a big environmental requirement on this, it was going to cost a fortune. And remember that these aren't standard. There were no BREEAM systems for them. These were all bespoke design things. So people were very nervous about, well, what does it even mean? am I going to have to do something ridiculous with this building in order to achieve excellence? So there was uncertainty. They were trying to avoid costs, but they were very committed to environmental performance. And we got a lot of support from them, you know, against occasionally the cost pressures that came on, because the client would turn around and say, no, I want this. You know, that's worth having. We'll have that. Thank you very much. So I thought it was a very interesting project from the point of view of a genuinely committed client, a design team that got to the answer actually by not thinking about it too deliberately, certainly not chasing points. I've worked on jobs where people sit there and go, if we do this, we'll get 2 brand points. If we do this, we'll get 1. And, you know, decisions are made like that. So this wasn't like that.
Not mentioned the website, the Learning Legacy.
Oh, yeah. If you haven't seen it, actually, one of the things, because the London Olympics has got this big legacy focus on it, one of the things they did was the Learning Legacy. Have people heard of that? Some people have. There was a huge amount of work done to capture the learning experiences, and it's all available online. So I've just talked about concrete specifications. There are downloadable papers and all sorts of guidance on how you can go about using, specifying recycled concrete. Key issues on this, for example, on exposed, because we've got exposed concrete everywhere here, is how you can get fair face finish using PFA substitution and recycled aggregates and what you have to do or what you can do. And I think the concrete quality in general is fantastic, considering, yeah, it'll never be happy. But anyway.
We have one more question.
Sure.
Yep.
First and foremost, I think you're all to be commended on an amazing building. I wanted to ask something. Is having an Olympics at the end of the construction of something like this, is it the ultimate deadline, like the ultimate... not cheat as such, but if you could take lessons from this and apply it to other projects which don't have such a weight of expectation and pressure on them, what kind of lessons would you give to those of us just working within the construction industry? And it's, you know, I love the idea of the bicycle. You put everything has a purpose. You don't over design. How do you take that into, I don't know, something like school design or office design?
On the time frame, I mean, you know, there's no London 2013, so it is an absolute deadline, and we were very key. When we were thinking about it, because actually something we didn't talk about is winning competitions like this isn't easy to do. I mean, there are 80 entries, and you really are up against the great and the good from around the world. And you have to succeed in your competition on a number of levels. You're judged all over the place. There's a design dimension to this, but there's also, do we believe you're committed to a program? Is your team professional enough to deliver to that deadline? Are you going to stick to our budgets? And so we were very careful about constructing an argument that said, we will come up with a design that you can definitely have in that time frame. We will control the amount of risk we take, the amount of innovation we put in it, so that you definitely get that time frame. And we did the same on cost. So we didn't have a splendid concept that would, that you would have to chase in time terms or cost terms. We came up with something that was reasonably flexible within the core principles that Mike illuminated there. So the time frame was absolutely critical. We would never have won if we'd gone into it with something that looked like it was going to take 10 years of research to deliver. We had to go in with a very practical, deliverable outcome. I think as a team, it felt quite long to me. I mean, we got quite frustrated with being run around the houses. There were too many people to convince everyone. So from our perspective, it felt like they had given themselves ample time, and we finished 18 months before the deadline. So I think they did. Although it was very top of their list of priorities, in fact, more important than money was program. They had, I think, honestly, their order was program, money, quality. You know, that in the mindset of our client, they would give on quality before they give on cost, before they gave on program. And we adapted ourselves to that model. But I never felt it. Did you feel it was a big ask, the program?
No, I mean, I think... in response to other parts of your question, I would say lessons learnt. You just can't write it down until you've done it. I mean, people writing briefs for these projects and everything else try and define what you're trying to do, and they probably come from a background more based on procurement, and they're buying something. And design is much more fluid than that. And I think you need to choose a good design team, and you need to trust them and push them really hard. Ed said that, you know, the cost constraints for this project were absolutely, you know, bearing down on us, but it made it's the analogy to the bicycle, you know, that's weight. Everything's taken out that's not doing something. And it made us work harder. So that was good. You need time to think it through. And I think the other things are sort of unstated so far, but actually British construction is in a good place. What we do in Britain very well is integrate engineering and architecture, and have done since Brunel and all these amazing inventors like Joseph Paxton. And I've worked around the world and struggled to find another country that quite brings engineering and architecture together as well as we do in Britain. And I think we got the contractor on board early, Pfeiffer and the cable net. There's a whole story we haven't even told where the people pricing the job said, you can't have a cable net, it's too risky. Go away and design it as a compression system. And we did have a whole scheme at stage C that was a conventional series of beams and tubes in the roof, same shape, and it would have had scaffolding and everything else. We didn't feel that was the right thing to do. And only when the contractor came on board, he said, okay, I can take 2 months off the program, I can save £1 to £2 million, and I can take 1,000 tons of steel out. And we went, yippee, he's right. We kind of knew it. But we had to have the contractor there with the specialist subcontractor, and they got commissioned by the ODA to go and do a special exercise, which was to research how this cable net would work, take the risk out. So we went with expedition to Schleich-Bergmann, who do all the cable net structures in Germany, done loads of them, and their team with Pfeiffer came and made sure it all worked. So you need time, and you need people to trust you.
Any more questions? I mean, we are quite advanced in time, but I think we can take one more too.
Thanks. I want to ask about the track. Was it that was the shape and all the angles worked out before the outside structure and the main building, or did you kind of adjust it after?
Yeah, Ron sort of went away and did his thing quite quickly and gave us a drawing of the track. But it's quite funny because he's so sensitive about copyright. He would only ever give us 12 points on the surface of the track at any one time. So we had to work between his sort of points on his beast blind or whatever it was he used. I didn't say it, but it's very, very simple, the geometry. He draws an oval at the bottom. He then has 7 meters of track, which is always straight. And all he's doing is changing the angle of that. It looks much more curved, but a section at any point is like those supporting beams. It's dead straight.
Did the track cycling people have any, like the GB cycling, have any influence, or was it just him?
Yeah, we went and spoke to them. And it was quite funny because, you know, from what I said before about longer tracks and fatter tracks, it's a bit of a battle between pursuiters and scratch riders versus sprinters. And then David Brelsford rules over all of them. And we got it all sorted out, and there's great debate, and we got the scoring box by the finishing line. Everything was sorted. And then this big argument came about where the finishing line would go, because, of course, you can move that round, and you can get the effect of the sprinters, which we've done a bit, by moving it further towards the bend. So it's a longer straight than Manchester, just marginally. So the sprinters get more time. But that conversely means if you're a sprinter and you're going out the blocks, you've got to get into that corner a bit quicker. So it's very political. And then you factor in the UCI, who are desperate for Team GB not to do very well at these Olympics. So they've eliminated the individual pursuit. So Bradley Wiggins won't be riding that. They've changed all the events around and are sort of fiddling with the laws. And you realise that the Olympics are a massively political exercise from every single aspect, with global interests sort of looking over.
Your point about the geometry. I mean, the geometry goes track, seating bowl and sight lines, which generates the top edge of track line, which generates the ring truss line effectively. And there's tweaking and we shuffle things up and down, but basically the geometry of the edge of the roof is driven from track, seating bowl and sight lines, edge of ring truss, and then we move it to get the Pringle forms and the double curvatures we need to work structurally and for construction.
A really stupid quick question then. There was a gap between some of the kind of track panels with light coming through. Is that literally an inch gap? And what happens if a cycle tire goes in there?
It's like the flooring in your house. It's sort of a millimeter, and that's to expand and contract.
Okay. It just looked like a lot more.
One more question, then we close.
Esther said that design is an ongoing process, even though the stadium is completed now. After it's been completed, did you think that you could have done more with it, like made it more sustainable, used more technology? And my second question is, even though it's completed now and it used the technology that's available right now, with the next 10 years or 15 years, with the technology advancing, how much can you tweak this building more to adjust? Because after probably 15 years, as energy consumption reduces because of technology, embodied energy becomes more important. So how much can you adjust the building, and how much could you have done more right now, even though it's done?
I have to say, compared to most buildings, it's ridiculously finite. I mean, the buildings wrap around the seats, wrap around the track, and it only really works for cycling. So it's not really a long life, loose fit building at all. And we took the decision early on just to go for it and make it exude cycling from every single aspect. So if you really pan back from it, no, it's a highly specific thing designed to excite people and not be a general building. So it's very inflexible in many ways. We did do things that other people hadn't done before. We put all the accommodation round underneath the concourse and realised we didn't need all of it. So at one end of the building, we just left an open, empty space. In the games, they'll go and use that and set it up. Afterwards, it's just, you know, it's got gravel on the floor, it's got concrete above you, it's unheated, and they can build and expand into that in the future. So that fitted our general thing of, you know, doing as little as we could. Other than that, I don't think technology changing will change much. I think, if anything, going back to my very first point in the picture of Herne Hill, social patterns will change. Why do the cyclists like it hot so they can go fast? Well, they're all competing at the same temperature. What the underlying thing about that is, cities are competing with each other. London wants world records, Rio will want world records, and so they're really actually trying to say, we want a really successful Olympics. So again, it goes back to this global politics. Cyclists actually go out when it's -5 and cycle, and they race at all temperatures. So it actually goes back to this much bigger thing of cities and the culture of Olympics and everything else. Not sure that answers your question, but...
I should just add that in terms of the technology, and you mentioned the thing about using the new technology to make it more sustainable, I don't think that will make it more sustainable. And I tell you, the thing is, like, we thought of the building as a whole, and we didn't rely, and especially when we design, and it's not only about the Velodrome, but like especially on the Velodrome, we looked at the measures that we can do with the building, with the form, with the architecture, and not rely on the technology. Exactly because of that, the technology will evolve with time. The building will last much longer. So the key for us was to make the building as the form, the fabric of the building, as sustainable as possible, as efficient as possible. And the technology, yes, if it evolves, like in 15 years' time, there will be need to change the technology, and you can change it. Like, and we always design to facilitate change and maintenance and replacement. But the key of the sustainability of the building lies in the form, in the fabric, in all of that, and not rely on the technology.
And if I can add something from what I learned from your presentation, the design is so robust that if in an extreme scenario you have to switch off your systems, you would have your daylight there to what you need, and you have your ventilation size, the natural ventilation size. You might not have your 28 degrees for the cyclist, but like Mike said, it's not a big thing at the end of the day. So it's a robust design. I would like to thank Paul Ben from BDSP for helping us with putting this presentation together, and of course, ultimately, Mike, Ed, and Gustavo for opening so much the truth so we can learn a lot about design process. Thank you.